There's a view of physics around the turn of the beginning of the 1800s, the sort of Laplacian view of physics. All there is just the state of the universe. All the particles in the universe with their positions and velocities, that's it. At one snapshot in time. And then there's just a giant differential equation, the laws of physics as a giant Markovian differential equation that take this state of the whole universe, all the particle positions and velocities, and tell you the next infinitesimally in time state and the next one and also the previous ones. And that's all there is. That's all there is to physics. That's all there is to the development of the evolution of physical systems. From this point of view, there's no sense in which that rock over there is causally responsible for the motion of that rock over
exactly.
there. Exactly. Right? Because it's like, you don't need that. You have the overall state and it's just sort of propagating forward and backward, this giant differential equation. There is no role to be played by having these extra ingredients, these idle wheels, these notions of causal influence. Now, when we teach Newtonian mechanics, we often talk about, oh, why did that rock begin to accelerate? It's because this other rock exerted a force on it, right? This other rock exerted a force on this rock and therefore caused it to move. But if you step back and look at the entire universe, there's just some giant state evolving forward by some differential equation. It doesn't look like there's any place for causation in this picture, at least at a fundamental microphysical level. Bertrand Russell said in the beginning of the 20th century, you know, causation is a relic. I think he said it was like the British monarchy. It's something that continues to persist under the erroneous assumption that it does no harm. He thought you didn't need causation anymore in physics, at least at the microphysical level. We should just get rid of it. Of course, if you get rid of causation, then there's no non-local causation. And then what is Bell's theorem even about? What is EPR even about? If there's no causation, there's no superluminal causation, and then the problem is just solved. I think if one takes the point of view, as some philosophers do, John Norton, for example, has a paper which you should also link to. It's called Causation as Folk Science, that there is no fundamental causation in nature, that science in the early days was about looking for cause and effect, but we've really become more sophisticated in that. We're not trying to phrase things in cause and effect anymore. You know, cause and effect is language we can introduce later just to simplify how we describe things. But like, we shouldn't be looking for physical theories fundamentally phrased in terms of cause and effect anymore. That's a relic of an old time. I think if you want to take that point of view, that's a self-consistent view. But then you're not going to be able to then appeal to Bell's theorem and say that there's non-local causation happening in hidden variables theories. If you want to talk about non-local causation, you need a theory of causation. You need to actually bite the bullet and say, we're going to talk about causal influences. And if you rely on interventionist causation, you run into the problem that interventionist causation just doesn't seem like the kind of fundamental microphysical definition of causation that we should be talking about. We're talking about microphysical theories like quantum mechanics. A lot of the no-go theorems that are related to Bell's original 1964 theorem, that theorem itself, the EPR paper, the GHZ argument, a lot of them help themselves to interventionist causation. They ultimately involve agents manipulating things, doing interventions. In a fundamental microphysical theory, which is just atoms doing the things that they're doing with no agents, no fundamental role of agents or interventions or measurements, it's not clear what these theorems are even saying. Bell wrote another version of his theorem, a generalization in 1975. It's a remarkable paper, and I think not widely read enough by physicists. A lot of people, I think, tend to focus on the 1964 paper. The 1975 paper is much more sophisticated.
I'll put the link on screen.
Yeah, you should put the link. It's a great paper. It's beautifully written. And in this paper, he tries to deal with this problem. I mean, he doesn't use the words interventionism, but he tries to get away from the reliance on measurements and on collapse. He retreats to a much more primordial notion. He just says, look, even textbook quantum theory is committed to some ontology, things physically existing. Measurement results. Textbook quantum theory says there are measurement results. That's a thing it's committed to. Those are the beables, the things that are really out there, according to textbook quantum theory. There are actual facts of the matter about how the measurements happened, and they're really out there in the world. He calls them beables. Not observables, but beables, the way things can be. Maybe that's all the beables you have. Maybe there are more beables in your theory, but textbook quantum theory only has those.
And to be clear, a beable is what? An ontological entity?
Yes. A beable is what you think is real. what you think is actually physically out there. And according to textbook quantum theory, you're committed at least to measuring things. Now, this, of course, raises some questions. If measuring devices are out there and they're really real, what are they made out of? In textbook quantum theory, there's just nothing. And you can't say, well, they're emergent, because emergence requires a substrate. Water, fluid water, emerges from water molecules. You need to have the things out of which the emergence is constructed. And in textbook quantum theory, you can't just say measuring devices are emergent without saying what are the things that it emerges from. In a theory like Bohmian mechanics or many worlds or indivisible stochastic formulation, you have those ingredients out of which the emergence is supposed to take place. But in textbook quantum theory, you don't. Okay, but that's putting all that aside. You're at least committed to the measuring devices, measurement results as the beables of the theory. And so Bell just, he rephrases the premises of his theory differently. He doesn't rely on interventionism. He doesn't even propose any theory of causation. He just says, look, I don't have a good theory of causation. I'm not going to give you a full comprehensive theory of causation. But I think any good theory of causation should have a certain feature. It should have a feature which today we would call Reichenbachian common cause factorization.
Right.
This is just the statement that if A is a thing correlated with another thing B, they statistically rise and fall together in some statistical way. And A and B do not causally influence each other directly, maybe because they're so far apart when they happen that they can't communicate with light, then there must be some other variable C that is causally influencing both of them. You know, so for example, if people have one condition, some medical condition, and some other medical condition, and it's clear that neither medical condition causes the other, but they seem to be correlated, you would think, oh, there must be something they ate or something they did that was responsible for both of them.
There's something like Nicolas Cage movies are released when people tend to die from drowning in swimming pools.
Sure. I don't know if that's an interesting suggestion.
Yes. Well, it turns out that it's because Nicolas Cage releases movies in the summertime.
Ah, good. Yes. So the common cause is summertime. Good. Yes, exactly. It'd be like saying, well, barometers show low pressure, and that's correlated with hurricanes. But it doesn't seem that the barometers are causing the hurricanes.
Right.
Or the hurricanes, which haven't happened yet, are causing the barometers. But that like there's a low pressure system that happens first, and this leads to both of them. Okay. So this is the so-called common cause principle. And what Bell asserts is that any good theory of local causation should have the property that local beables, whatever they are, they could be measurement results, they could be beables in some other sense. He's being very general about this. But local beables associated with distant places, if they're correlated, there must exist other beables in the past, in the causal past, in the so-called overlap of their light cones. That's the fancy way of saying it. And there must be a rich enough set of those beables, a rich enough set of them, that if you specify them all and know them all, then they explain the correlation in a very rigorous mathematical sense. They lead the joint probability distribution for the two things, the two beables, A and B, they lead the joint probability distribution to factorize cleanly when you condition on the local beables in the past, the common cause local beables. This is called Reichenbachian factorization. I don't know that Bell knew about Reichenbach's work. Reichenbach had formulated this idea in the 50s. And it's certainly something you could imagine a good theory of causation should have. Bell needed this factorization in order to derive his inequality with these weaker, more general assumptions. And this 1975 theorem was general enough that it could encompass probabilistic theories, theories with stochastic hidden variables, where the hidden variables didn't uniquely determine measurement outcomes, but only determine them probabilistically. So this is a more general theorem, but he's changed his premises. And now he's taking on this premise that in order for a theory to count as locally causal, his principle of local causality is, again, it's locally causal if whenever we have statistically correlated local beables A and B that are far enough apart when they occur that they can't be causally influence each other, then there must be a rich enough set of causal variables in the past that when you condition on them, the correct joint probability distribution factorizes in this neat way. And this is necessary to get the theorem. Now, I'm not the first to suggest that Reichenbachian factorization is too strong a requirement, too strong a condition to impose on a theory of causation. Others, you know, Bill Unruh, for example, in a 2002 paper, which I can also link, has this long explanation. She says, well, yeah, I mean, the things got entangled. There was some interaction that entangled them. But in quantum mechanics, interactions are not variables or beables. They're not the kinds of things that you can condition on. There was a common cause, the interaction in the past, but it's not the right kind of common cause to get a factorization. So there's no problem here. And various philosophers of science have made this argument also. There's a bunch of papers by Jeremy Butterfield, who's a philosopher of physics at University of Cambridge, who also has cast doubt on Reichenbachian factorization. Why would we even think Reichenbachian factorization is good? Well, it kind of works for everyday macro world joint probabilities, but that's not a strong argument that it should also hold for microphysical probabilities. And there are already good reasons to be suspicious that in fact it should hold. So, but this just sets up a target. If you deny that Reichenbachian factorization is a good requirement of any good theory of local causation, then Bell's theorem has no teeth. It simply doesn't work anymore. Now, in a lecture Bell gave in the early 90s called La Nouvelle Cuisine, which is in his collected works, Speakable and Unspeakable, is this collection of all of his papers, but not the first edition, the second edition of Speakable and Unspeakable. He has this lecture. It's called La Nouvelle Cuisine, which we can also link to. He tells the 1975 theorem story over again, and he modifies the premises a little bit. He modifies the premises a little bit. I've been having an email correspondence with a philosopher of physics, Ioana Luc, about this. She's working on a paper where she's looking at all the different formulations of Bell's theorem. And in 1991, he slightly changes the premises a little bit, so he's not relying on exactly the same kind of Reichenbachian factorization, but he still needs all these sort of like assumptions about what a good theory of causation could be. He's not proposing a theory of causation. There are many theories of causation historically. There's regularity theories to say that A causally influences B is to say that when A happens, B happens, or later, or counterfactual theories that A causes B just in the case that B would not have happened if A had not happened. And there's conservation law causation, and there's probability raising causation. There's all these theories of causation. Bell doesn't propose a theory of causation. He just says, I think a good theory of causation should have this feature. And if you assume this feature, you get this inequality. The inequality is violated by quantum mechanics. Therefore, whatever quantum mechanics is, it doesn't have this feature, therefore cannot have a good theory of local causation. But he didn't propose a theory of local causation. So this is a very long way of saying, in the indivisible stochastic approach, we replace the differential equations. We no longer have the Schrodinger equation as a fundamental equation, or Newton's laws, or Maxwell equations, or any of that. We don't have those things anymore. Instead, we have these conditional probabilities, this sparse set of what I call directed conditional probabilities. I'll explain the directedness in a moment. But these directed conditional probabilities are exactly the kinds of ingredients that show up in the literature on causal modeling. When you do probabilistic causal modeling, you've got random variables. These are the things that can change, and they've got links between them that describe causal relationships. And those causal relationships take the form of conditional probabilities. The probability of B having certain values, given that these other variables have their values, and we would say, therefore, that those variables causally influence B. This is exactly the language in which the laws are formulated in indivisible stochastic formulation of quantum mechanics. So you might think, well, they're phrased in a way that provides a very hospitable domain for talking about causal relationships. Maybe we should read those conditional probabilistic relationships through a causal lens.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in. And now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.